community care transformation. What that means is out of hospital care. We can't continue to have a care model that's entirely dependent on the acute sector. In fact, 80% of the work that we do is in primary care. And we know that GPs are under a massive amount of pressure. And we're fortunate on Wirral that we have a really good primary care offer. Other parts of the country are struggling desperately to get GPs. We have strains on our recruitment, it's nothing like other parts of the country. And then our final segment within better care is about improving quality. So let's not forget that even when I'm going to talk about money in a minute, quality is a really important issue to us. Let's not focus on that. And then finally, the last circle there talks about better value. And we have to talk about value, we have to talk about money, because it is a real issue. Because if we don't do something, we'll end up in that position. I have to say, because we've had a discussion about resources, it is worth noting, I mentioned it to note and for no other reason, the way we're funded with NHS is on a capitated basis. And the formula by which the CCG receives income is on that basis. It's a weighted formula, it takes into account deprivation and the age profile. But actually, if you use that, the CCG is not resourced to the level that it ought to be by about £11 million. In other words, that sort of spread across the country, some areas get a bit more, some areas get a bit less. And over time, they're trying to adjust that. And so that puts further pressure on the fact that actually our population need is greater than the resources that we receive as a CCG. For us, that means our CCG is extremely challenged financially. We on Tuesday had a meeting in public, and we did declare that we could end the year with a deficit position. And that's a very serious position to be in, because we'll need to try and develop a recovery plan. So that's a bit about the in-year pressure. So it's really important that we have an honest discussion about where can we look at the best value for our pound. So that last circle there talks about estates. Are we getting the best use of our NHS estate? But let's not talk about the NHS estate in isolation of the public estate. And so the work that the council's doing on one public estate, the CCG's participating in that as well. We're looking at accountable care as a different kind of delivery model. And again, that was mentioned in Graham's paper that Moira presented earlier. And we're looking at population health management, which has come up as a theme this evening about prevention and intervention. And perhaps, not this evening, but at the time, we could talk a little bit more about some of the work we're doing. It was mentioned in the previous report about Cllr, which is an IT solution-based technology. But we're driving technology really hard to such a degree that Wirral is seen to be a national exemplar for using technology as a method of identifying those people most at risk in the community that we can intervene earlier. Perhaps we could do another session about that another time. So that's the four circles. If I was to just pick out a number, Wirral residents live healthier lives is one of the blanching areas. If I was to pick out this area about improving out of hospital care, if I pick out reducing unwarranted variation, because actually we know in looking across Cheshire and Merseyside, if you look at the admission rates at East Cheshire, to hospital compared to the admission rates on Wirral, if we had their admission rates, we could save a couple of million pounds. So we have to look at out of hospital care, but we also have to look at unwarranted variation, because we have lots of variation within the NHS, and there's a real opportunity there. We're looking at specifically at exploring accountable care, and we're looking at how providers, acute hospitals, sustainability and transformational plan is looking at. And you might have heard of STPs, because there was a lot of press about them, and continues to be a lot of press about STPs. And we've been looking at those areas, and they translate into managing care in the most appropriate setting, looking at what warrants of variation, looking at back office functions in hospitals to see if we can share those, and looking at different ways of working, i.e. accountable care. So the Cheshire Mersey level, they're the four themes that we're working on collectively to see if there's added value in trying to do that together. I say that because we're looking at functions, not at form. Other parts of the country, you'll have heard about A&E proposals to close, wards to close. That's not the approach we take. We've taken the approach to say, if we focus on those big ticket items, the form will come later, and we don't know what that form is yet, but we need to do that work. So it's a bit of assurance, really, that STP does affect us, there's lots of work going on, and we're trying to build the evidence base to understand that. So they're the areas. So coming back to Wirral, so I hope you can see how our Wirral plan gets read up to Cheshire and Merseyside. Rather than the Cheshire and Mersey tell us what to do, it's a bottom-up and top-down process. And then, I know this is really busy, but what it in effect says, each of those segments within those circles has a chief executive lead and a sponsor to do that work. And that's a and this is my all the work behind it. So you can see each of the plans and how each of those plans relate in terms of priority to our system. So, Wirral residents live healthy lives. I'm one of the sponsors for that piece of work. But in that strategy is our alcohol strategy, it's our leisure strategy, our culture strategy. So you can see how they all come together in a single place to have a single plan that doesn't look at health in isolation of the wider determinants of health and health and care and domiciliary care, the impact on care homes, etc., etc. The reason it's colour-coded is some of this work needs to be not just Wirral, it needs to be Wirral and Cheshire, and some of this work needs to be Cheshire and Merseyside, and that's why there's different colour codings. So it's a bit of a patchwork, but it makes sense when it's all brought together into a single plan in a single place. Thank you.
That was really helpful. Thank you. Questions, dare we ask? Yeah. Anybody?
Can I just ask one? A lot of younger people now are being diagnosed with mental health issues. I just wondered if you've been led this way, but I think if they get diagnosed with mental health issues, they're affecting the people. One of the big pieces of work that we're doing is we're actually investing in capacity to work in schools, yeah, to actually provide support and care for children and their families in schools rather than send them into the health
centre. I find it's more scary going to
us. So we should be moving the care from a kind of health service setting into schools and trying to get to people earlier, because the earlier that you intervene when someone has a mental health problem, the better outcomes you get. So we're actually doing that piece of work together at the moment, we're implementing it at the moment.
Thank you, sir.
Moving on to item
there's data available at this stage, and that's quite important because there are lots of elements that we haven't yet got on the data. So we haven't presented the whole suite here as part of the suite today. Issues about it. What happens with this for me is, in essence, it picks out the highlights, and highlights of those areas of practice are identified. And in terms of the more detailed elements from page 127 on, then there's a brief summary in terms of some of where it's taking place and some of the issues that are going to be on it.
Right, and what you've got there, but also there is another set of data that is online, which is much more detailed. Now, if I start the discussion, I hope, without confusing things too much. When I looked at that, I thought that really doesn't tell me anything much at all. You know, it's nice, but it doesn't tell me anything. And then I was going to be in the direction of the stuff that's online, which is very much more detailed. Now, the problem is, what does committee want to see in terms and how in terms of getting a picture that's clear enough to know when things are going in the right direction and in the areas that are going to be? And do we just want to look at it in terms of the pledges or are there things that are slightly suspicious of the side of the pledges that we might want to look at? And I'm very, very open to listen to the discussion and work from there as to what we get presented on a regular basis. From my point of view, the information that's online, while it's very useful to go and look at as an individual, it's too detailed to go into committee. It would completely dominate every committee. We don't do anything else except for performance budget. I mean, that's what we want to do, but I think we want to know something about the services that we're going to do as well, rather than just feeling what's happening. So I'm really hoping somebody's got some clear ideas of how to move this forward this day, but it's probably right. So if you would. Go on.
Thank you, Chair. I think your point is actually very well made in the sense that you could end up being here till midnight quite comfortably dealing with it. But is it possible that we could identify those prolonged rents, those things that, in the great scheme of things, continue to cause us some difficulty, and we treat those as a theme for a particular meeting? I accept also that I think my colleagues would also like to look at things that are outside of the general remit, so that we don't miss anything.
The suggestion was made by the Scrutiny Sports Office that we theme it. My worry about that was that we should still theme the meeting. We only meet 4 times a year. We only meet by the best at all. But I think one way of doing it would be to identify the rents. What we said in the past about performance indicators is that we sometimes miss those that are hovering around the borders or deteriorating, but look as if they're performing within the targets but largely deteriorating, and we haven't actually paid enough attention to that. But Adam, did you want to say something?
Yeah.
But that's one way to start in anyway, identifying the consistent level.
No, I know I'd actually as a general point of statistics for any need. I have numbers. And there's ways that we can display numbers as an outfit which don't hide things, so using means, for example. There might be a way to take each pledge and create some kind of aggregate of what the individual indicators are to give us an overall picture for that individual pledge. Something in the office is there, isn't it?
I just wanted to comment on the good progress being made in ensuring Wirral's neighbourhoods are safer. I'm one of my people.
Not really, no. What you've got in front of you.
It's in here.
It's in there because what you've got is all the pledges. Oh. You've got all the pledges for the three different.
Yeah. Can I comment on that? Sure.
Yes, thank you, Scott. Oh.
I just wanted to. It's really tied up with another part where I read about the number of people in Wirral over 55. Rather worried about going out during the day or in the evening.
These really are to do with this. Oh. They're not to do with this committee, Walter. They are to do with the Environment Committee. Although you've got them presented in the...
Yeah, I know, I've got a comment in here, so
yeah. It's really tired.
I just wanted to say that, you know, Merseyside in general is a pretty safe place. And I must say for myself, I've never been anywhere in Wirral at any time of the day or night and felt that I should be worried about my safety. And I think Merseyside in general is like that. I know downtown Birkenhead on a Friday or a Saturday night is probably the most dangerous place. And I remember speaking to the chief constable and asking him why. And he said, because people know each other. Where if you're in Liverpool, we're from all over the place.
Okay,
and I just wanted to comment on that.
I just wanted to make a couple of points. I welcome, I think it's good that there was a performance as well, but that's been recognised that previously we haven't had that, so it's a balloon, isn't it, a balloon comeback. So I think that's really good. I'm thinking about the previous kind of performance and management framework that we've looked at. There were some issues there that haven't carried over into this, and there were issues where we'd identified that there were challenges. So I would still like those, and I think Claire spoke about them last time she was here. I would still like a mechanism for us to have some overview and oversight of those areas where we have identified that there were challenges that haven't automatically translated through this time.
This set of indicators is purely for the 2020 pledges, and the 2020 pledges are